Our hymn to Apollo has a second part. This part of Apollo's story is centered on the temple at Delphi. Delphi, a very famous place in antiquity, has a long and deep connection with Apollo. You'll remember in the previous lecture, we were trying to make sense out of this rupture in the middle of our Homeric hymn to Apollo. On the one hand, we've got Apollo connected with Delos. We talk about his birth and coming out of Leto and the drama that surrounded that. And then all of a sudden, we move stories and we're centered on, moving into a story that centers on Delphi. The suggestion that was made in the previous lecture is that what we might have here is a single hymnist's attempt to bring two very different traditions together into one hymn, and that way please both sides of a powerful audience. Those at Delos that like to think that Apollo is especially connected with them, and those at Delphi that think Apollo is especially connected with them. This author gives them both pride of place and cuts out some of the parts that maybe would have made the transition a little bit abrupt. For example, you don't get a second birth story in the Pythian side of this tale. That's something that happened on Delos. Instead, we've got Apollo appearing. He just sort of shows up. And themes carry over from the earlier part of the hymn that we saw into this second piece of the hymn. Apollo is frightening. He's a very powerful god, and the other gods are a little concerned about him. His power causes people to shake. His grandeur is so grand that it causes some anxiety. The geographical lists show up again. Apollo's kind of making his way around the Mediterranean as he moves the Greek coast and farther pieces of the Mediterranean as he moves around trying to find a spot for him now to build a temple. He needs to find his place on earth. And those place names, just as we saw in the earlier hymn, are connected with specific features of Apollo's cultic worship. There are temple sites at these places. There are other pieces of Apollo's background that map onto these geographical locations. Each of them has a connection with Apollo. And again, the hymnist is in a kind of encyclopedic attempt to get all of the traditions around Apollo, listing them together so that it's his way of being able to join together lots of different Apollo traditions into a single hymnic form. Apollo, as he emerges and causes some fright among people, declares his purview. Once again, we have a prophecy, song, medicine. These things show up and come out of Apollo as he declares what his purview is going to be. Prophecy here is to declare the will of Zeus, which means that Apollo's being careful to say, yeah, I can see into the future, but don't mistake that for saying that I'm the one that controls all things. Instead, he cedes to Zeus, his father, to say that, yeah, Zeus is the one whose will controls the future. I'm the one that can see it. There's Apollo being careful to, yeah, sure, he wants to say he's authoritative and powerful, but he wants to make sure also that everyone realizes he understands his role is subordinate to Zeus. Our main story is Apollo trying to find a place to settle. He's looking around, trying to find a place where he can build a temple. That place turns out to be Delphi. He establishes rites and gets himself set up. So once again, a sense of a god in search of something, a god in search of a place, trying to find a spot where you belong. That's definitely true in our Homeric hymn to Demeter. She needs to get reacquainted and rebuilt, built back into her Homeric, her Olympian society after this trauma that happened with her with Persephone. Well, Apollo now is just trying to find his spot. Where does he belong on Earth, and what kind of rites are going to be established in his honor? In Apollo, I think the ritual dimension of this story is extremely pronounced. What else do we have going on here in the story aside from Apollo trying to find a spot where he can be worshipped? This seems to be a really important part of what gods want. They like it when you and I pay attention to them. We're a critical piece of their identity. Trying to find that spot and establish it in Apollo's hymn really comes through as a critical part of him finding his own place in the universe, as finding a place for all of us, human beings, to worship him. We hear a story of Telephusa, who is a personified spring. She shows up and says, well, hello, Apollo. He says greetings, and he's about to build a temple there. She says, you know, maybe you don't want to build a temple here when the beautiful plains that are all around me, she's personified here, are going to be trampled, and people are going to, all the horses and the chariots and everything are going to be kind of washing across this plain. When they do, they'll be admiring me. And you'll be jealous, you want them to admire you, so you should go somewhere else. Apollo listens to this and decides that having all these horses moving around in this wide open plain is not going to work out. So what does he do? He goes up into the folds of Parnassus. beautiful photograph of the layout here. You'll see that there's the sea. You can see way off far on the edge. We're actually looking from the perspective of Delphi itself here, looking down the folds of Parnassus across the plain. The wide open spaces down there, yeah, there might have been horses running around and chariots, but go up the hill and you don't have that room for people to be making gestures with their herds and horses. Instead, you get into Delphi's territory. And there, people's movement is a little bit more hampered, constricted, and in fact, there's a focus, a literal geographical focus on one spot, and that is this wonderful temple shrine at Delphi. And looking back from the temple site down the fields, we see this beautiful thing set up there. Those of you who, some of you will have already visited this spot, it's quite moving. Who knows, there are some of you taking the class that are living down the road from it. If you are, go take some snapshots and share them with us. It's quite an amazing site. Highly recommended that you should go take a look at it. This site at Delphi, Apollo finds it. This is going to be his special spot on Earth. He's ready, sets up his temple. He's going to get himself established. He's finally found a place to be. In our hymn, we have a description of Apollo getting going on the process. Let's just focus on that. Apollo spoke and laid out the foundations, wide, solid, and very long, and a stone threshold was placed by the sons of Ergonus, Trophonius and Agamedes, friends of the deathless god. The endless human nations raised a temple of carved stone to be sung about forever. A lovely spring flowed near, where the noble son of Zeus killed a huge snake by his stout bow. There, a savage, bloated monster who brought outrage continually on the country's people and slender-footed sheep. A gory curse. We hear about this monster, don't we? And Apollo's slaying of this nasty, huge snake that's hanging around his spring right nearby is his conquest in order to secure a safe zone for those around Delphi to worship him. Now, you'll recognize that as we start talking about this snake, all of a sudden we get, you know, dozens and dozens of lines talking about some other monster. You'll recall from the Hesiod's tale of Zeus's conquest that as Zeus is trying to order the whole universe, there's this monster Typhoeus that comes up at the very end. After Zeus has conquered everyone else, Earth produces Typhoeus, and then Typhoeus comes and attacks Zeus. After Zeus slays Typhoeus, well, then he's established. That's the last challenge at his authority. In this case, we hear a long digression on this monster, here called Typhaon, but it's clearly the same one. The story varies in some of its details, but mostly it reflects the same kind of a thing, talking about Zeus's conquest of it. And the relationship between that and our snake is not absolutely obvious unless you reread it very closely. What the author is saying is that this monster that Zeus slew, famous Typhaon, well known throughout the universe as the last impediment to Zeus's authority, whom he slew, very tough customer, this one has a relationship with the snake. The snake actually served as foster mother to this creature and raised Typhaon up. And so the connection, I think, that the author is trying to say is that, sure, Zeus slew Typhaon, but our god Apollo slew the mother of Typhaon to give that extra kind of monsterly credentials. Monsterness of this snake is credentialized very powerfully by saying it was such a monster it could serve as foster mother to Typhoeus, really among the most famous of these nasty creatures that sprouted up in the early generations of creation. Now, the comparison here, I think, suggests very subtly that Apollo's power in the universe is very strong, so strong, in fact, that some might have made a claim at some point along the way that Apollo was actually superior to Zeus. Don't find that in the literary tradition. Don't find mythical references that talk about that. We don't have a battle between Apollo and Zeus. Zeus is top dog and always has been top dog in the mythic stories. Apollo's careful to talk about himself in a subordinate position to Zeus. But it's stories like this and the story that talks about all the gods being terrified of Apollo and how powerful he is, all the places that are scared to bring him in, that I think suggest very subtly that those partisans that backed Apollo as their local divinity and god might well have had designs on trying to think about him as being top dog in the universe. Then from there, we get a story that builds. We've got the conquering of Pytho. That gets linked to a couple of or to an important word that helps us understand what Apollo is all about. The list of epithets that show up in this story, each of them are attachments to Apollo's name. Pythian Apollo, Telephusius is another nickname that Apollo gets. Apollo of Delphi, Delphinios. These are terms that get linked with Apollo in the tradition of rites that surround him and epithets attached to his name. Our story is giving us a reason for thinking how it is they got attached to him. They're telling the story behind these traditional names by which we know Apollo. Pytho is the name that the beast gets because it comes from a Greek verb meaning to rot. After Apollo killed it, the beast rotted there on the plain. And so term Pythian gets attached to Apollo. Telephusia seems to recall Telephusa, that water nymph that we saw down on the plains that talked Apollo out of settling his temple there. That helps us understand a cultic epithet of Apollo, Telephusios. Then also Delphi, and just the story of the name there gets pulled out in our story. The final closing bit, Apollo's trying to search for someone who can attend his rites for him. He needs a human population to surround his temple and execute his rites on his behalf. And it just so happens that some Cretan sailors come washing up on shore, and Apollo thinks, well, sure, let's go see what we can make here, and shows up to them in the form of a dolphin. Laid out in the hymn, you have to read very closely, but yes, indeed, talks about Apollo flopping up dolphin-like onto the ship. When he does, they're scared, they're not sure what's happening, this huge monstrous beast out of the sea, and then he starts to take over their ship and guide them around. Lots of places are visited that have to do with Apollo's cult, and eventually Apollo says, you know, I'm here, I'm the god, and you're going to be my people. I'm going to bring you in, and you can now tend my rites for me in this site of Delphi. So that term, Delphi, comes from this Delphinian background in the story. The Greek term Delphis actually just goes ahead, is a direct, their direct way of saying dolphin. So it's connected in this story to Apollo the dolphin. Now Apollo has got himself settled. He's got his home at last at Delphi. Beautiful temple that he's built there, a lovely place that's situated just right, that he's figured out how to make it just work just right. He's got people who can put his rites together for him. He's settled. And the cult of Apollo is now free to flourish at Delphi. His home there is made. He's home at last. Apollo has his place settled. Now, we're going to take a turn in some of the materials in this course. There's one more tool that we want to pull out of our toolbox in the coming lecture. And then from there, we're going to move on to a different genre altogether. We're going to start talking about Greek tragedies in the coming week. These things are going to be quite wonderful. I look forward to reading those with you. One more tool in the toolbox, and then we'll move on to tragedy.